the dynamic Emma Peel in action, played by someone who Laurence Olivier once called a brilliantly skilled and delicious actress, Diana Rigg. Well, Diana, looking at that, do you do all your own stunts? Did you do all your own stunts when you were doing The Avengers?
No, I didn't. I couldn't. Some of them were too extraordinary. And secondly, we sometimes filmed two things concurrently, so it was much easier for the stuntman to go ahead and double me in some of the fight scenes while I was doing the dialogue scenes, in which he couldn't double me. And the ones that I could do myself, I did. And the first 14 episodes, I did most of them myself. Much aided, I must add, by the stuntmen.
Was it as much fun to make as it looks?
Yes, it was. I loved doing it. I couldn't go back because it's just too hard. One worked from 7 o'clock in the morning till 8 o'clock at night if you're out on location like that clip that you saw. And it was very physical. You had to learn the dialogue as you went along, very concentrated. And I had that sort of energy those days, but I've still got energy, but I don't think I could do it again.
You were, in fact, at the time, a very successful classical actress, working with, or you had worked with, the Royal Shakespeare Company. Mm. How come you got the part of Emma Peel on a TV series?
I don't know. I tested along with hundreds of other ladies when Honor Blackman left. And I met them in the corridors. They were doing all the film tests down at Elstree. Thousands of ladies were passing by in black leather and all that stuff. And I thought, oh, well, give it a whirl, and went in and did my bit. And Patrick was enchanting and lovely and kind and helped a great deal. And then when I did it, the producer took me on one side and said, well, Diana, I think not. And I said, yes, I think not too. Yeah. And apparently the next day they saw all the film clips and gave me the job. And 2 days later I was doing it. So really, I don't know a great deal about fighting because I had to learn as I was going along.
Yeah. How did your friends in the theatre react to that, though? I mean, sort of in the Shakespearean company. Was it a bit of a come-down? Or?
I think initially, yes, because in those days, telly was really very infradig. I mean, I'm talking about 10 years ago now. Mm. And straight from Shakespeare to The Avengers, which I'd never even seen, so I didn't know what it was about. Mm. They teased me a lot. But I didn't mind. I mean, it was all sort of all experience. And I went back to them, of course, halfway through The Avengers.
Emma Peel always looked sensational, very independent, well organised, pretty tough. Are you in any way, Diana Rigg, like Emma Peel?
Yes, I think that the essence of Emma Peel is oneself, all those accessories like being able to fight, like knowing everything about engines and computers and that sort of thing, is very far removed from me. But I think what she represents, in a way, is quite close to me. That
let's look at the independence.
Yes.
Because I think you have been known to say that, you know, I am independence, independent. But is independence like being a rebel? I mean, are you rebelling if you're independent?
Not necessarily.
And are you a rebel in any way?
I used to be. When I was an adolescent, when I was a child, then there was something very definite to rebel against. But when I was young, then, yes, I was a rebel.
What sort of things did you rebel against, then?
I was at quite a strict school, and I rebelled against the sort of discipline which I considered mindless. Walking on the left-hand side of the corridor, having your tunic 3 inches above your knees, only having your hair touching the collar of your blouse, not talking at certain periods of the time. Not only that, but the whole communication that went on between teacher and pupil was practically non-existent. Mm. They were establishment. You were considered something pretty lumpish and stupid, and you could never actually get a relationship, a teacher-pupil relationship. I didn't have much communication with my own age group and found it awfully difficult to treat the teachers with the degree of respect that they demanded of me simply because they were teachers.
You did, in fact, go to a boarding school for a time, didn't
yes.
you?
Yes.
Was this something else you rebelled against? Did you find it sort of intrude on your privacy, perhaps?
No, I didn't rebel against that. In fact, I think the seeds of one's independence were sown then because I went at 8 for 2 years and then my parents were abroad and didn't see them. So one learnt to evolve one's own life at a very formative period and learnt to do without parents.
You say you're not really a rebel now, but you are very outspoken. Do you like to shock people?
No.
No?
No.
Well, Is it just that you're sort of perhaps Yorkshire upbringing, that you like to call a spade a spade?
Yes. And the fact that people find it shocking is because they've probably called a spade a shovel all these years, and suddenly they hear spade and thoing. You know, I don't do it for the sake of shocking, because I'm not interested in that at all.
No. But you quite often use four-letter words publicly, which, you know, I mean, obviously would shock people.
Yes, it's becoming much less shocking now. I mean, once upon... I'm doing a play now where the word bloody created a furore the first time it was spoken on the English stage. Mm. They still laugh now, but it's not the same sort of shocked laughter as they did on the first night in 1925, I think, something like that.
Have you always been a bit of a ham? And as a child, were you always in the school play? And
yes.
Perhaps a bit of an exhibitionist or something?
Never an exhibitionist, no. Deeply sort of... introverted, but pushed myself to do things. I was the first thing I did was Goldilocks, and I just happened to be a very big Goldilocks, a very lumpish 11-year-old.
But you didn't see it like that. You took it quite seriously.
Oh, very, very seriously. Yes, yes.
You came from you were born in Yorkshire actually,
yes.
And you came from a non-theatre family.
Mm.
How did your parents react to you going on the stage? Did they object to it in any way?
I think they were very worried because it's difficult to explain to people now. The world has widened so much and things have changed a great deal. But a Yorkshire town, Leeds, city, they'd call it, an actress was a Scarlet Woman.
Yeah.
An actress was automatically promiscuous, suspect socially, stupid, and they were very worried. My parents were extremely worried. Not only that, imagine their dilemma of having given birth to a child and suddenly she says, I want to be an actress. It's rather bewildering and puzzling for them. They can't help you. And parents really want to be able to help their children. They couldn't help me. I had to do it myself.
Well, you did, in fact, didn't you? Because you won a scholarship to RADA. Mm. Do you think that's a good way to start if you're an actor?
No, I wish I'd gone to university. Because I'm terribly conscious of great mores in my knowledge. Great. Gaps. I don't have the languages I want, the fluency in French. I don't have the reading, the background of reading that I wish I'd had, and I'm catching up on it as fast as I can now. But it's all a bit late.
Mm. What was your very first walk-on part?
I carried a spear. The famous story. Most men usually carry spears. Big Butch D-Rig had to carry a spear. And Peter Hoare and I, when we meet now, we laugh about that a great deal.
Mm. Well, you have, in fact, played a tremendous amount. I mean, looking back at your career, I mean, you've played a tremendous amount of roles. It obviously didn't interfere with your growth as an actor. Roles in TV, you've been on the film and the stage. Which medium do you prefer as an actress?
Theatre is more familiar to me, and I think you love working in the most familiar thing. And I love people being there. It's the truest sign of whether you're succeeding or failing, because immediately you sense, you get it immediately back from the audience, a quiet, that they're listening, a laugh, you've made them laugh.
Is that why, then, that you haven't developed perhaps the film side of your career very much? Don't you fancy being a big film star?
No. I wish I'd done one really good film that I could be proud of and say that I'd sort of succeeded in that, and I've not succeeded in any of the movies. My face actually is not too good for the movies. Even the Avengers, I got away with it, you know.
Mm.
But I'm better on stage because I've got a big face, and all the biggest film stars that I've met, and I've met, you know, most of them, they all have tiny features which photograph exquisitely, you see. Me, I've got big features and they don't work.
Well, let's take a break there, Diana, but don't go away, because in the second half of the programme, we're going to see a lot more of Diana's face, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it. So join us then.